Because I'm sure there's somebody that might be going through exactly the same thing, and to see what God is doing. Amen. Let's turn our Bibles to Matthew 5. Like to call it the Beatitudes. Don't be an attitude, Beatitudes. Don't have an attitude. I just want to start reading, and I know from Matthew 5 and go on, and I know I'm not going to finish this today, this morning. I'm going to finish this evening. But, you know, we've been talking lately about, God has been talking about repentance and turning. And God has been giving us directions and guidance. Amen? Let me turn. But I want to kind of read, because when we talk about what is blessed, and just going to let God have his way, we're going to start at the first verse on Matthew 5.
Matthew chapter 5, verse 1, New King James Version. And seeing the multitudes, he went up on the mountain, and when he was seated with his disciples, came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them.
I want everybody just to underline that he opened up his mouth and taught them. To understand that this is the Son of God, and he's now, not only is he talking, he's teaching. I mean, you know, when somebody's teaching, they're trying to give you an understanding. They're trying to give you direction. Amen? They're trying to put you in a position of where there is clarity. Everybody with me? He opened up his mouth. The Son of God opened up his mouth, and the Bible said he began to teach them. Who is he teaching? He begins to talk to his disciples. Those who are he's getting ready to teach his disciples something. Do we have any disciples in the house? So since we are disciples through the apostles' doctrine, let's get taught this morning. Let's let them teach us. Go ahead.
He opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven."
I'm going to tell you what's interesting about this, and I want everybody to get this. We like using the word blessed. I'm blessed and blessed. I'm blessed, blessed. But I love that in the Beatitudes that Jesus Christ is getting ready to say this is what he considers what being blessed is. And it's kind of interesting that I like when you look at the end, the New Living Translation, it says God blesses. And he said God blesses those who are poor and realizes that they're in need of him. God blesses those. Somebody, that means to be blessed is to know that you are in need of God. Amen? That's a good place to be at, to be blessed, to know that blessed are the poor in spirit, to know that you are in need of God. I am in need of God. Because you have a lot of people in life who don't think that they are in need of God. Amen? There's a revelation, he talked about a church that says they were rich, but evidently they were not rich because they didn't understand that truly being blessed is being in need of God. There are a lot of people who perceive that they are blessed with this and that. But I love the description. He says, blessed is those who are in poor in spirit who know that they are in need. Is anybody in need of God in here? Then God says, blessed of those who know. Because when you know you are in need of something, you're in a position to receive. When you don't think that you are in need of anything, you're not positioning yourself. But when you think you are in need of something, you are positioning yourself. And it's a good thing to position yourself to receive from God. Amen? Go ahead.
Verse 4, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted.
And I like, he says, God blesses those who mourn, for they will be comforted. In other words, God ain't mad at you. God says it's blessed when someone is in a mourning position. Because if you're seeking them, you know, if you need them, It's a good time to need him at a time where you are mourning. But what I love about it is that he says you're blessed when you realize that you are in need of him, but you also are blessed when you are mourning, because he's the answer. He will comfort you. Amen? It's a good thing to know that you need God, and even in the times that you are mourning, to know that you need him, knowing that he said, I will comfort you. It's a good thing to know that Jesus said that you're blessed when you know you're in need, because God is the God who can comfort you. Now Jesus is talking. Y'all have to understand something. He's talking to his disciples, and he's saying, blessed are those that mourn, that because, you know, I'm going to comfort. Because he's letting them know you're going to go through some times you're going to be mourning. He's talking to a disciple, one who is going to be disciplined in the word of God. He says, blessed are those who mourn, but I'm going to be your comforter. He's giving them, they're going to be a comforter. So a disciple will understand, there are going to be some times that you're going to be mourning, but God says, I will be your comforter. That's good news. You need to know that as a disciple, that when you are mourning, that God will be your comforter. See, it's kind of interesting, because some people, when they don't really understand the first one, both blessed those who are poor in spirit, and they're prideful. They instead of going to God when they're mourning, they go to alcohol, they go to drugs, they go to other things to comfort them. But I found out when you are poor in spirit and you know you need God to solve your situation, God says, blessed those who are poor in spirit, because God is going to be there for them. And when you are mourning, he said, I'm going to comfort you. Jesus is talking to his disciples. Go ahead.
Verse 5. God blesses those who are humble, for they will inherit the whole earth.
God says he loves somebody humble. He said, blessed are those who humble. They have an inheritance. That means, I want us to understand something, disciples. Those who are disciplined in the word of God understands that their inheritance comes not by any other reason other than being humble. Being in a position to be humble with God puts you in a position to get an inheritance. They're going to walk with some power over the whole earth. Amen? The humble can walk with some authority over the earth. Go ahead. And this one, like I said, I'm sorry. Like he said, I want you to remember, he's talking to his disciples. He's telling his disciples, stay humble. Your inheritance is going to come by you humble. God, you know, when a man humbles himself, God can exalt him. God's promotion plan is humility. Go ahead.
Verse 6. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled.
Somebody say hallelujah. God said, blessed those who hunger and thirst for justice, for they will be satisfied. One says that. In other words, God says, you know what? It's good for a disciple to have an appetite. It's good for a disciple. And if you get a chance, we're going to go over, like, when you read Matthew 6, it's kind of interesting. It is good for a disciple to have an appetite. You know why? Because he says, blessed those who hunger and thirst. But you know what? As you continue to read, Jesus said, I'm the bread. He says, I'm the bread of life. So if you're hungering, it's good to hunger for bread. He said, Jesus, I'm the bread. And then he says, you know, I'm that living water when you're thirsty. So when you're looking for bread, and when you're looking for something that's that hungering and thirsty, you need something going to give you some substance. Jesus, I'm that bread. And what I love in each one, he says, I'm the bread of life. It's, in other words, I'm going to be that thing that you're going to fill you up through life. I'm that living water. I'm going to be that thing that costs you to never thirst no more. What I want you to understand, and what we need to understand, is that when you're hungry and thirsty after the right thing, when you're hungry and thirsty after God, he begins to quench the appetite. When we are hungry and thirsty and move in lust, that appetite is never quenched. He is the living water. He is the appetite that leads you to everlasting life. He is the living water. He told the woman at the well, I'll give you water that you'll never thirst again. But you know what was funny? When he talked to the woman at the well, he asked her, where your husband at? She said, I have none. He said, you've answered correctly. She was trying to fill her thirst with a man. She was trying. People, we always trying to fill our thirst and our hunger with something that cannot fill us or quench it. Have you been there? Money. If I could just get more money. If I can get more money, I'm going to be out. How many of us got more money and we still wasn't happy? All we did was spend more money. You know what I'm saying? We got more money and we like, I'm good. Now I'm going to get on top. Now you're back in debt because you went. But he's telling his disciples, he's saying, those, let me explain something, disciples. You're going to be gifted. You're going to have, you're going to move with power. But I need you to understand that all the things that the world can offer you cannot make you full. Cannot fool your thirst. He said, I'm going to give you water. And you know what's funny about what he said, living water. He said that you will never, I'm going to give you water to continue over and over. And with the woman that was married, he said, you've been married 5 times. You would think by 5 men, she would realize that men is not the answer. Some of us in this room want to say hallelujah. Some of us should realize women are not the answer. If I could just get that one right there. If I could just get that one right there, she a little finer. If I could just get that right there, he got a little more money. You're going to still thirst. That's why I love your generation tonight. She's so thirsty. Yeah. Y'all got it. You got the right word. You just need the revelation from it. Because God said he like a thirsty generation. Because he wants you to drink from that water that you will never thirst again. And then he told it. You know, he kind of messed up too. He said, the five you had, and the one you have now is not your husband. And then she got all spiritual. Sir, I perceive you to be a prophet. You know, she got spiritual on her. He's trying to answer her problem. What was he trying to tell her? You have been trying to find the fulfillment of your life in men. Some of us in this room, you need to start evaluating where you're trying to find your life fulfilled at. Some of you are talking about, well, when I get that job, when I get that status in that position, I'm going to be good. I promise you, you won't. God is the only one. He had to tell his disciples, he said, I am the fulfillment of life. If you don't understand that when you get married, if you don't understand that when you get a job, what's going to happen is you're going to start getting false expectations. You know what a false expectation? You're going to start having false expectations for your husband and your wife. You're going to think that they should be the one filling your thirst. You're going to think they should. And what you're going to find out is they don't have really the power to do that. Now you're going to get disappointed. God never gave anybody to you to replace God. Let me say that again. He never gave you anybody to replace him. He may give you somebody to help you worship. He may give you someone to help you do his work. Amen. But he said, I love, he says, he's that home. He said, when you're hungry, he said, I'm that bread from heaven. He said, your fathers came. He said, they had raiment, but they had to keep getting it. He said, but I'm that food that you eat that you will never come on. And when you start getting, that's what happens with people when they come in religion. When they get mass religion, they get upset. You know why? Because they still hungry and thirsty. That's why they sit in church all day long, come out, God, give me this. God, give me that. God, give me a husband. Because they still thirsty and hungry. But if they really got Christ, if they tasted and saw that the Lord was good, you don't understand what I'm saying. Don't get me wrong. You can want a wife or a husband. You don't need one. You can want a permission. You don't need one. Why? Because God is the completion of who you are. Because guess what? You was dead. Nobody can fill you up. No one can give you life but God. People can make you feel good for a few minutes. That ain't life. Do not confuse pleasure. Because the Bible says in the last days, men going to be lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. In other words, they going to want their flesh to feel good. When they going to want the pleasure, but they're not going to want God. What is God? They're not going to want real love. They're not going to want that. It can bear, it can believe, it can hope, it can endure. So he's talking to his disciples and he's getting them to understand. And I'm going to tell you something. It's nothing, ladies. It's nothing more appealing than a man who is thirsty and hungry for God. Men, there is nothing greater than a woman who has a hunger and a thirst for God. Because God is an answer. And he has the answer to every situation. Go ahead.
Verse 7. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy.
As a disciple, you know that you are called to be what?
Merciful.
How many of us want some mercy? Come on, raise your hand if you want some mercy. You better testify. Let me tell you something. Then give mercy. Then be merciful. God is not mocked. Whatever a man, he shall. If you want mercy, then be merciful. If you always condemning, if you always judging, if you always, you gonna get a. Blessed are the merciful, so they shall obtain mercy. God was merciful to us. How are you gonna receive Christ and not have mercy in your DNA? I'm not. I had a person tell me I'm not. This. I had a woman tell me. She said, no. Oh, he gonna respect me. He gonna respect me. He gonna respect me no matter what. He gonna respect me. I'm not gonna. And then I told her, I said, well, you know, we didn't respect. A lot of us didn't respect Jesus. Well, that's Jesus' problem. He gonna respect me. And if he don't respect me, he gotta go. Okay. She has no desire to give any mercy. So she will receive no mercy. Because it's kind of hard to go to God talking about what you're not going to tolerate when he's tolerating so much from you and me. Are you greater than he? Go to God, tell him what you're not going to put up with. How somebody not going to talk to you. How somebody not going to look at you. How somebody not going to act around you. But you talking, acting, and walking around God like you ain't got no sense. And don't get it twisted. Just because they don't hear it out of your mouth, God see your thoughts. They don't know I'm rude. God know you're rude. He see what you're thinking when you don't say it. Look at somebody. I say, man, I'm going to take some. I'm going to sow some mercy. Because mercy is renewed daily. I'm going to sow. If you want mercy with your kids, please be merciful. You get old, you're going to want some mercy. With your kids, please be merciful. Why you don't come visit me at the door? Well, you ain't come. You ain't show no mercy. I'm hungry. Where you get something to eat? I'm hanging out with my friends. You ain't show no mercy. Okay. I know what I'm talking about. When I read this, what makes it stick out in my mind so much is who he's talking to. He's talking to those who are going to be apostles, carriers of the message. He's talking to those he expects that he's going to anoint and they're going to have the Spirit who's going to go forth and spread his gospel. He's talking to them and he's saying to them, this is what blessed is. But I don't know, somewhere along the line we took blessed was what you driving. How you, what you got on. What you got, all the stuff you got, who you got, all the, we think I'm blessed. And then, how do we know that? How do you know that's the revelation we got? Because when we don't have that stuff, we sad and depressed and oppressed. We're not meek when we don't have what we want, we rude. And that's why I love the song that God had us sing earlier. Because he deserved it. You know what the problem is? You know why people can't, a lot of us can't praise God? Because you mad you ain't getting what you think you deserve. We mad because it's not green. But the bottom line is, let me tell you something. If you accept the Christ, when you receive Christ, the grace of God, you and I didn't get that because we deserved it. So that's why he deserved praise, because he gave us something we didn't deserve. You know, because you know, in a society where people say, well, why good people die first? Why is the good people good? We love to call people good people. Why things always happen to the good people? You might want to ask God to pull back the stroll on some of the people that you're calling good. Because I know when the young rich would roll up on Jesus, when he rolled up on Jesus, tried to kick that little saying, that good master, Jesus, hold up. Slow your roll. There's only one good. But we love that. She was a good woman. What was good? She just was good. She was saved by grace. So anything that you saw good in her came from God. So glorify God.
Go ahead. Verse 8. Mm-hmm. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God.
Say, Lord, wash my heart. Blessed are the pure in heart, so they shall see who? He said, blessed when your heart in the condition to be able to see him. How many know when your heart angry, you can't see? When your heart full of bitterness, you can't see God. When your heart full of lust, you can't see God. But when that word start washing your heart, and you start getting that word into your heart, guess what? You start seeing God. What does it mean, see God? See his desire for things. You begin to see God's desire for things when you get yourself out the way. So you look at that homosexual, and you're like, ugh, because your heart ain't right. But when you got God's heart, you see God's desire is, I want that person delivered. See, when you can see through God's eyes, you might keep your mouth closed a lot. Too. Because what you might condemn, what you may unqualify, what you may think don't add up. See, David, I'm sure his brothers, they didn't see him like, even Samuel didn't see it. Lord, this a boy. See, you know, God, man judges the outward appearance. Man look at you and measure, and a lot of people, even Christians, try to measure compared to what they think they know. But since God is looking at you, he may not even looking at you where you at right now. He's looking at what you're going to become. He know what you're going to become. So that judgment, their prediction is so wrong because all their prediction is what they see right then. But see, God don't, no. Some of us in this room, we rejoice like the woman of God says, I don't deserve these things that God has added to my life. The truth is that you don't deserve. Don't nobody, you don't deserve your kids. You don't deserve your husband. You don't deserve your wife. You don't. What makes you think you deserve death? And only by the grace of God. That's why you ought to treat it so well. That's why you ought to treat it so special. Why? Because you understand, I don't even deserve it. So, baby, how you doing this morning? Why? Because you are a gift from God. Matter of fact, if I was in the world, I would have never even chose you. So, therefore, and I'm so glad God chose you for me, because I wouldn't be blessed right now. You don't have to take my word for it. Go read Proverbs. I think it's Proverbs 18. It says the father has an inheritance. He can pass down his houses to his sons. But only God can give a woman you can trust. God says, I'm the one that gives the inheritance. Your father can't give you this inheritance. This comes from the father. The father only can give you one you can trust. Say hallelujah. Somebody say, bless it. When the last time you heard somebody say, walked around talking about, I'm blessed because I'm meek. I don't think I ever heard somebody say that, tell the truth. Yeah, I'm blessed because I'm meek. I'm blessed because I'm poor in spirit. We too prideful to say we poor in spirit. Not me. All this word I got inside of me, all this power, all this anointing power I got. What you mean, poor in spirit? Huh? God lucky to have somebody like me, you know what I'm saying? He lucky I come to church. He lucky I can move. Boy, all this stuff I do for my God, poor in spirit. He lucky I come. Come on, God. You need to be praising me. That's the mindset we are. But he said, blessed are the poor in spirit. Why? Because they know they need God. When the last, man, we need God, I need you. whatever. I don't know. I'm going into a new, God, I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to, Lord, I don't care all the PhDs you're going to need, God. Why? Because you still got to deal with people. Anybody got to deal with people? No. You need the Lord. Because people will switch up on you quick. Go ahead.
Blessed are the peacemakers.
Bless. Oh, do we have any peacemakers in the house? Woo! Blessed are the peacemakers. Thank God for the peacemakers. But watch what he say. Blessed are the peacemakers. Who are they?
For they shall be called the sons of God.
Let me help you if you're a peacemaker. If you're a peacemaker, they know you're a son. Blessed are the peacemakers. Peacemakers. You know, some of us like, yay. Some of us, we're not there yet. We stirred up. We like fire. We like, huh? But God, a peacemaker can agree quickly with his advocate. He a peacemaker. Let me help you what makes you a strong peacemaker. When you know that God will take care of it. What makes you a strong peacemaker is that, see, it's hard to be a peacemaker when you feel like somebody got to know what time it is. It's hard to be a peacemaker when you saying, oh, you, I know you ain't just try me like that. Who you think you talking? You must be talking to the woman next door because you ain't talking to me. How many of you know our society does not promote peacemakers? We like this. You do me, I'm going to do you. You roll up on me wrong, I'm going to roll up on you wrong. You say something slick to me, I'm going to say something slick to you. Eye for an eye. That's why we can't get no peace in the house. Why? Everybody trying to get the last word. I can see some of y'all faces like, that's the problem. Yeah, that's it. A peacemaker might have to hold his peace. The Bible says they were despised. Jesus was despised and rejected, but yet he opened not his mouth. Peacemaker. Sometimes you got to hold your peace. You ain't always got to let somebody know I'm a man. Well, I'm the woman. Let them know God got it. I'm going to tell you something. It's a learned behavior. Yes, it is. But I think when you keep bumping your head, you'll be like, God, you'll get like the poor in spirit. When you keep bumping your head, you'll get like the poor in spirit. God, I kind of need you in this situation because I'm tired of sleeping on the couch. I'm tired of arguing. I'm tired of going on. You know that roller coaster ride where it's good one day and y'all act like y'all are loved. Then the next day, y'all going through it all over again. This everlasting roller coaster ride because nobody really want to be the peacemaker. Because you know what y'all know what we feel. If I don't say it, it's not going to get corrected. He or she will never understand me if I don't make them understand. Y'all know, right? You know, women, you liberal. You know, women, y'all, woman to woman, not, you know, no man's going to walk over me. No man, I have to let that man know what time it is. Man, excuse me. Don't go to the, this ain't the biblical days anymore. You done got it twisted. Oh, I'm going to check you. I'm going to be your helpmate, all right. I'm going to help you get right. And God and Sarah were talking about, Sarah like, hold up, woman. Blessed are those who are meek in spirit. Though. They said, woman, hold up. That's not, I don't act that way, woman. Sarah, shh. That was your time. Well, maybe if you adapt Sarah's spirit, you'll get peace in your house. Y'all, come on. I don't know why I feel this in my spirit. We like to sing the songs. The battle's not yours, but the Lord. But we always want to fight. Because you don't believe that God will get it right. But see, I learned.
Yes, I did.
You think I'm joking? Oh, yeah, I learned. After 20 years, you learn. If you don't, you're kind of foolish. You learn after a while, it might be better for me not to say nothing in this situation. It might be better for me just to serve in this situation. Baby, you hungry? Here. Baby, you all right? Then later, I found out later when I served, my wife come, babe, you know that when I said to you the other day, I apologize. But I never brought the situation up to her. See, we don't believe. Why don't we believe God can do it? Okay. The disciples better believe it because they want to be blessed. He's saying this comes along with being. See, this ain't just an everyday sermon. He's giving you the ingredients on being blessed. He's telling those who are going to be disciplined in the word of God, this is a blessing. So if you want to be blessed, read it again.
Blessed are the peacemakers.
If you want to be blessed, then put into your arsenal to be a peacemaker. Can I get an amen? Man, look for peace in the situation. Don't look for being right. Ooh. Don't look to be right. Look for peace. Let me say that. I wish we can grasp it. Stop looking to be right and look for peace. See, that's why your prayer is wrong. Your prayer is God proved them wrong. God changed this heathen. Your prayer should be, God, teach me how to get peace in this area. Teach me how to bring, what do I need to do, God? How do I need to die to get peace in this area? Why? Because I'm your son. And your son understood peace all the way to the cross. Some of us gonna get that. Your son understood peace all the way to the cross. Okay, all right. Let's go. Let's finish this up. Go ahead.
Verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. The persecution is because of righteousness, not because you ain't pay your bill. The persecution is not because you're not a peacemaker and you got to run your mouth to your boss. You're not being persecuted because of righteousness in that area when you ran your mouth to your boss. You're being persecuted. You're actually being corrected because you don't post on, because number one, honor that which God has placed over you. Boy, it's quiet in the house today. But see, he wants his disciples to understand this, because to be disciplined in the world, to be disciplined as a disciple in the word of God, you got to understand you're going to be what? Persecuted. Yeah. When you stand for truth, when you stand for the word of God, there's a persecution. How many know God says it's a blessing in being persecuted for righteousness? So God is not in heaven crying because you're being persecuted. He rejoicing because you're standing on the word. Because somebody is able to see God on earth. When you stand in righteousness, somebody's able to see God on earth. When you don't do evil for evil, somebody's able to see God on earth. When we don't slander somebody, somebody's able to see God on earth. How many of y'all are noticing that the blessings kind of interact with one another? Because guess what? You got to be a peacemaker to be at peace when you get persecuted. And your peace has to come from a place beyond the situation.
Go ahead.
verse 11. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake.
So everybody say falsely. If it's true, don't be. If it's true, why are you mad? If they told you that you lying and you lying, why are you mad? If they told you you stole something and you stole it, why are you mad? But blessed, he said, you are blessed when they persecute you and you didn't do it. When they talk, do you know how many so-called Christians walked away from God because somebody persecuted them and said rude things to them? They didn't realize they were being blessed. I'm serious. I know somebody who told me a story of a situation.
I know somebody told me a story of a situation. A lot of words just say a simple thing. You know what I'm saying?
I know somebody told me.
Do it again.
That a girl, their friend, walked away from God because somebody kept saying to her,
you know what, you old Jesus freak.
They kept talking about her because she was saved. They kept saying negative things. So the person said that's why she left God. She didn't realize she was being blessed. Why is it blessed when somebody persecutes you and speak rude? Why? They are acknowledging your position. They are giving reverence to what you stand for. Go ahead.
Rejoice. And be exceedingly glad.
Yes.
For great is your reward in heaven.
He said rejoice when that happened, right? And be exceedingly glad because you're going to get a reward in heaven. Anybody want a reward in heaven? Then you're going to have to be able to deal with some suffering on earth. For his name's sake. For righteousness. Amen? Go ahead.
For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you.
Yeah, he said, those who spoke the heart of God before you, they persecuted. When you true, let me tell you something. In the society today, disciples, we who are repenting, who are being baptized in the Holy Spirit, we are repenting, who are being baptized and filled with the Holy Spirit, which has caused us now to be a witness. You're going, what? Now you are went. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. And when you speak in truth today, but we found out what? Last week, the week before that, that it's going to come a time that you're going to have to what? Defend the faith. And when you begin to speak the truth and defending the faith, guess what? People are not going to like you.
Y'all better, God preparing us now.
He's talking to his disciples who he is preparing to send into the world. He said they're not going to like you. But some of us, the reason why you're not going to speak truth because you want everybody to like you. But he says, but blessed when they're not going to like you. They're going to revile you. They're going to talk about you. They're going to speak rude of you. How many of you know right now, if you are a person that says, you know what, I love all people. Yeah? But if you are unmarried or you are in homosexuality, if you are unmarried and you are in homosexuality, that is a sin. I love you, but that is a sin. Do you know that people gonna say, man, they will call you intolerable? They'll say, you know what? You wrong, you know what? You don't, they got it. Why? Because you're standing for the word of God. There was a couple, there's actually a couple, I don't know if y'all know, they do a show called Fix It Up. There's a couple that does a show, Fix It Up. This couple goes to a church of God. I'm talking about, and the pastor be preaching the gospel. Do you know that the so-called liberals on their side, they want to cancel, go, they're coming after them, not because of anything they said, they're coming after them because their pastor preached a sermon on the fact that homosexuality is not, it's a sin. So they're coming after them because they are attached to a pastor who preaches, all their pastor is doing is telling the truth. Wait a minute, sex without marriage is a sin? What, so we're not going to talk about these things in the church? We have to what? Not to condemn anybody. God don't want to condemn you. He loves you. He wants to bring you into order. Just like a mother. A mother is not going to ignore her child playing with an electric socket. Unless that mother got issues. She going to try. Am I right on? She going to try to get that child. Why? Because she know that can kill him. God don't want you to die. That's why he wants to pray. He gonna talk to you to try to get you to turn from that behavior, because he know that behavior leads to death. And I promise you, you and me, God is not going to change his word because we say, well, you know what? Well, society is changing. And we're becoming more tolerant. Well, I'm gonna put it to you like this. No matter how much society changes, the word of God is not gonna change. So you jump on that bandwagon if you want to. You jump on that liberal bandwagon if you want to, that you can just do what you want to do. And you know what? And you know what? Everybody should just love everybody. And everybody, you know what? And that person has the right to love who they want to love. That person, well, since the creator who created you said that's out of order, I wouldn't do that. Why? Because you're not going to get the best outcome in that situation. Should the clay say to the potter, no. No, bottom line, God is the creator. We the clay. Line up. Everybody say, line up. Go ahead.
Verse 13. You are the salt of the earth.
Now I want to show you something. He spoke to his disciples about being blessed, about persecution, about poor in spirit, seeking him. And then he shifts to a minute because he's talking to the disciples and says that you are the what? He said, you are the salt of the earth, because the humble inherit the earth. He said, but if you're going to be in the earth, you're the salt. You're not, if you're humble, you got power in your humility. In your humility, you're salt. Woo! In your humility, in your poor spirit, in your ability to be persecuted. In other words, for you to be steadfast in who I am, you become. How many of you all know this? That salt will change the flavor of anything you touch. It's so overpowering. If you put it in steak and you put too much, something can be sweet. Ice cream. You want shoes? Put some salt over it. It changed the flavor. He says, look at someone say, you are the salt of the earth. Don't tell me that God didn't save you for purpose. At your job, you better be the salt. In your house, you better be the salt. When God sent you to the grocery store, you better walk in there like you're changing something. He said, you the salt of the earth. But you got to be humble to inherit it. He said, you're the salt of the earth. Anybody, man, I want to be the salt. Go ahead.
You are the salt of the earth. Mm-hmm. But if the salt loses its flavor.
Uh-oh. He said, if the salt can't salt, if the salt can't make you salty, if the salt can't change the atmosphere, you better hear what God is saying. Because remember now, God has been talking about repentance. But now he's talking to his disciples about blessings. And now he's setting them up to be in a position to be salt. But he said, now if you're going to be the salt of the world. But he said, that's salt. Because I'm going to tell you something right now. The reason why God is getting ready to raise up a remnant. Because it seemed like the salt has lost. Go ahead. If it lost what?
If the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned?
If the salt loses its flavor, how can it be seasoned? What is God saying? You know what? But it says to be trodden over the foot of men, right? That's what it finished saying. Mm-hmm.
Can you make it salty again? It will be thrown out and trampled underfoot as worthless.
Let me tell you something. Do you all notice how comedians, do you notice how people make mockery of the church today? They ain't got no, they have no fear of God. When people open up their mouth today, that's kind of a testimony of the salt. Make more. I'm going to tell you something. Y'all think I'm joking, but I know y'all going to say, Apostle, you over the top. Man, I don't find Tyler Perry movies funny no more. I don't find them funny no more. Matter of fact, the more I begin to get in God's face, I don't find them, I find them actually ridiculous. And one reason, because it seems like in his movies, every time there's a pat, he always make a man of God look like a mockery. Like it's funny. It ain't all. When a man behind, when you get behind that pope and preach the word of God, ain't nothing funny about that. That word is life. But if I can keep you laughing, you'll begin to realize you don't even realize you ain't got no power no more. No. God says, how precious are the feet of those who preach the gospel. You ain't going to mock us and make fun. No, that ain't funny. Don't touch that which God has ordained. Because when you type, you don't realize, the more you let somebody play with it, the less they begin to value it. No. The salt, when the salt, it's the men, I'm going to tell you something, men trodden over the church. You wasn't, God is trying to tell, listen, some of y'all are going to scream on this one. He didn't design you to be walked up over. Matter of fact, if you read scriptures, the Bible says that Jesus put his foot up on the enemy's head. You have no business being on the bottom of anybody's feet. You ain't hear what I'm saying. You're not hearing what I'm saying. You were not called to be walked up on. You were actually called to walk up on. You were called to triumph the adversary, to destroy the works of the enemy. You were called to go to your job and not be crying and murmuring about how mean your boss is. You were called to go to your job and sprinkle some salt and people begin to say, I need Jesus. You were called to be. He's talking to the disciples. I'm telling you, if God sent you here today, it's because he's trying to tell you that your mandate is as a disciple, is that you understand that you are called to be the salt. And guess what? If your life ain't affecting nobody, maybe you done lost some of your salt flavor. People feel comfortable around you to just say anything. They want to act any kind of way because why? Because you're not going to love them into order. You notice how I said that? Love them into order. Your girls think it's all right to call you and tell you who they laid in the bed and who they met in the club with. Really? She's not going to believe that you're going to tell her, baby girl, you're too special to do that. You're called for greater than that. Some of us, you're vicariously living it through her, so you ain't going to say nothing to her. Your flesh getting excited by what she's saying. Keep on going.
Verse 14. You are the light of the world.
Woo! He said, not only are you salt, but you're the light of the world. How many of you know, do I have any people here the light of the world? How many of you know that a little match can change a whole atmosphere of a dark room? He says, you're the salt. He's talking to his disciples, those who he have blessed, those who have, he told, when you persecute, if they persecute for my name's sake, rejoice. Those who he has told what blessings are, now he's telling them, now that you know what blessings are, now that you know how to what? Be meek and spirit, how to strive for me. Now that you know how to walk in me. Now that you know how to stand with me. Now I need to set you for me. He said, you're the light. God called you. No, tell me, you guys say, you, when you were saved, you became light to the world. You illuminate. In other words, the world should be able to see God through you. I just go to church. That's the world's problem. That's their business. I ain't got time for their business. When darkness got business, once light, watch this. When darkness got business, when light stepped in the room, guess what? Business exposed. He says, you're the light of the world. Go ahead.
A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden.
He said, you're a city set on a hill. You can't hide a city on a hill. Why? Everybody can see it. God says, when I saved you, my purpose, y'all got to understand this. He said, see, you're looking for, like, there's nothing wrong. You're looking for, am I a singer? Am I a dancer? Am I this? Am I that? He says, your life I want to set on a hill. He said, you might not do nothing in the church, but your life, I want to sit on a hill. He said, I want to make you light that everybody can see my glory. And they ought to be able to see God in the sons and daughters of God. They ought to be able to see God in you. How you going to get pregnant and nobody know you pregnant? You can't get pregnant with the Holy Ghost and nobody know you're pregnant. You sitting in church every week. They talking about grace, grace, grace. You say, now, okay, I got grace. You got grace. And while you sitting there, All you're sitting there for is trying to find out what God got for you next. What God got for you. Go live a life that reflects the glory of God. Your house should be changing because you changed. Your job should be changing. I'm not saying you got to go in there talking about, you go in your job talking about, yes, I thought I'm also talking about, they going to fire you. Like, I don't know what happened to her that day. She just started speaking in tongues and I didn't understand what she was saying. Come in your job talking about, they were like, she happy. Coming there too many times talking about that happening. I'm like, you fired. But you come in your job what? Being respectful. On time. Yeah. Say, help me, Lord.
Help me, Lord.
Submission. Doing what your boss tell you to do. Not backbiting. When they had a little backbite party, they should, well, we can't invite you. You know you're doing something at your job when they have a little backbite, they won't invite you. When they buy, we have, we going out to, we going to eat. Don't invite Skittles. Why? She going to be sitting there talking about Jesus. She going to be talking about, well, I don't want anything to drink. Don't invite Skittles. Invite Tina because she'll, no, I'm joking. Tina like, let's turn it up. No, I'm just joking. I rebuke that very word. Yeah. Now I need security when I get out of church. You know what I'm saying? No. Honestly, they people know who they, y'all think I'm joking. People know who to invite. They know who to call late at night too. They know who to call and who they dealing with. They know who to call. Them butt people know who to call. What you mean, butt people? You know, I like apostle, but you know, them butt people know who to call. I really love apostle. He a good man of God, but you know what? And they be like, but what? They know who not to call. Also, excuse me, but I don't want to hear that. If you got an issue with them, go talk to them. I just wanted to tell you what was on my mind. Go tell him what's on your mind. I can't benefit you. I can't benefit from all. You ain't gonna drop no seed in me. I don't want the seed. That baby gonna be aborted. I'm just being. Come on, God. Come on. We turning right. We turning. If we gonna turn, how many know when you repent and you turn, you gotta know how you gonna walk after that. You don't turn and get saved just to go sit in church 30 years. Go stand before God. God, I know I'm coming in. God, I was on the deacon board for 15 years. God, I went to church every day. And God be like, yeah, but when you went home, you was most disrespectful. You talk to your mama like you're talking to a dog. I couldn't give you a job because you wouldn't submit to nobody. You still hate your dad, even though I told you to forgive him. I didn't. Bye. I love you, but I can't let you in. Why? You was in the church, but you never let the church in you. Because the Bible says if you bear no fruit, he gonna cut the branch off and cast it into the fire. It ain't about how much fruit you bear. You got to bear some. Hear what I just said? You, it ain't about how much fruit you get. Don't worry. Don't compare yourself to nobody else. You got to bear some, though. In other words, you can't receive a seed and it don't produce anything. God is not, God not sterile. Amen? Go ahead.
A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden.
Can't be hidden. God is not trying to hide you. God is not trying to hide you. He put you right in the midst of the mess. Why me? Because you shining. Why me? Because you the salt. Stop saying why me, salt. Stop saying why me, light. Why not you?
Go ahead.
Verse 15.
Uh-huh.
Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket.
He said they don't. No, they don't light it and put it. They don't hide it. Go ahead.
But they put it on a lampstand, and it gives light to all of those who are in the house.
I love how. How many of y'all know you love how he said it gives light to all those in the house? So everybody say, start at home first. If you can't give no light in your house, if nobody in your house know that you the light or the salt. Because you go home and you playing cards with everybody else and you cursing and you throwing. They ought to know if you have turned, if we have repented and turned and been baptized in the word of God, meaning as a disciple, because a disciple becomes submerged in the word of God, becomes disciplined in the word, then people ought to see that in your life. They should see that you bless. They should see the fact that you crave for God. They should see that you are hungry and thirst no more. They should see that you can be able to withstand through persecution for righteousness' sake. That you're not folding under. Man, they talked about me at my job. They talk about, oh, Jesus girl, or holy roller. And I'm like, I hate when they say that. So you hate? So what you want them to call you, Sean? What they want you want to say? Ooh, look at that thought. They call you holy roller. Why? Because you are a reflection of the Father you represent. Don't be mad if they hate you. Wherever there's haters, there has to be a lover. Wherever there's haters, there have to be a lover. And Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my. I want y'all to remember that statement. If you love me, you'll keep my commandment. Okay, go ahead.
Verse 16. Let your light so shine before men.
Oh, yeah.
That they may see your good works.
So he said, let your light so shine before who? Amen. So that means on your job, you should let your what?
Light shine.
I can't hear you.
Light shine.
That means, guess what? When you in the gym, you ought to let your what?
Light shine.
When you in the grocery store, you ought to let your what?
Light shine.
When you in the car driving here with your wife, you ought to let your light what? When you in the house and nobody else can see you. That's you and your kids, the ones you cursing out. You should be letting your business transaction. Let your light so shine that men may what? So they can see your good works. What good works? The works that he has declared, the blessed you are, the good works of the word of God working in you. He said, let your light so shine that men may see your good. Watch this. Y'all got to get this. Finish it. What did it say?
Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven.
Can I get somebody just to scream on that? He didn't say glorify you. He said, if you let your light shine, if you let God shine through you, because Jesus said, I'm the life and the light to all men. When the word is lighting in you and you let it shine, the Bible says they're going to glorify your. That's why Jesus said, I always do those things that please the Father. He said, I let the word shine in me. Whatever the Father tells me to do, I do it. So when they see me, the Bible says they ought to be glorifying God because of the sons and daughters upon earth. Come on, I don't see the United States glorifying God. Matter of fact, we done created about 130, I don't know, about 50 more gods. We want to take them off the money. We done took them out the courtroom. We done took them out the classroom. Took them out of the job place. That don't sound like they glorifying God. But I read in the scriptures, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves. He said, if you humble yourself, I'll give you the world. But we have to turn. We have to turn. Because when we turn, you hear, he said, you got to turn from your wicked way. And when we turn, we become a light to the world. And guess what? God has given, what? We don't even understand this. There is power in you when you turn. You are the salt and the light of the world. When God turns you from sin, he fills you with the Holy Ghost. And now you become a witness to the world. And where darkness is, he said, I'll send you as a sheep among wolves. He said, I want to see you in the darkness, but let your light so shine that men may see your good works, that it will bring glory to your Father. I'm so tired of men glorying men. They had Jerusalem, even in their fallen state, had more sense than we do. You know what they would do when the apostles would move with power? The Bible said they would glorify God. And when they tried to glorify the apostles, the Bible said they ripped their clothes. And Thomas said, we are men just like you. Glorify God. But now we got men behind the pulpits who seek glory for themselves, wanting you to call their name, running to and from to see them. I want to see God. But to see God, a seed must fall to the ground first. Humble himself. Be transformed. Or abideth alone. Meaning all they see is the seeds. Without you and I humbling ourselves, all they see is you. Even though you have great potential, all they see is you. I don't want nobody seeing me. I'm like Paul, I got a glimpse of me. I don't even want to see me. But I want to see Christ, for Christ in me is the hope of glory. No longer I live, but Christ live. And the life I now live, I live in faith in Christ Jesus, who gave his life for me. See, there was an exchange when you turned. When you repented, you were baptized, you were exchanged, you were submerged in Christ. And when you were submerged in Christ, he took away your thirst and your hunger. He was there to comfort you when you are mourning. He is there, guess what? He's there when you need him. He doesn't sleep nor slumber. He's always there when you need him. And that's because sometimes God don't come when we think we shouldn't come. You know why? Because he's trying your heart. Because some of us, God, come on. How many of y'all know? A lot of us start out excited at first. That's why the Bible says he will endure to the end. What do I mean excited? We have a situation. We start the race real excited. You know what I'm saying? They get excited. But then as the race go on and things don't go the way we want them to go, people start losing their interest. They start fading away. You know why? Because they really came to church for God to do something for them instead of receive something from God. And when God doesn't release what they think they need at that moment, they go find another avenue. But I like the first one. He said, you got to know you need him. Poor in spirit. Lord, I want to be poor in spirit. Why? That I understand that I always need you. I don't want to. It's easy. I'm going to tell you something. When you start, things get added to you, like not blessings. When you start adding, when you get a job and you making, you're making good money and your husband making good money, or you start, and you can get your own car and, you know what I'm saying? You got all this stuff. It's easy to start. It's easy to start really forgetting about, being poor in spirit. See, the enemy want to replace you being poor in spirit by making you rich in stuff. That's what happened to that church in Revelation. He made them rich in stuff. But when Jesus said, you're not rich, you're poor. See, let me tell you how I know what I'm saying is true. Because when we start getting this stuff, we start adding blessings to it. So now we define blessings to the stuff we get. So now we think we ain't all right with God because we got stuff. But when you get persecuted, you get angry. You don't display the care. And people don't talk at work. You're not talking about, God or living God. You're talking about the stuff you have. So you're sitting around talking about basketball games and everything about the world all day. Amen. Go ahead. Let's finish this part up. Where are we at? Okay. Well, actually, we're gonna finish there. I'm gonna finish the next part this evening about the law, because it's interesting. After he do all that, he goes to the place of the law, and I'm gonna tell you, I hope you come back this evening, because I'm gonna tell you something. People have been making the law seem like it's some wicked, evil thing. They've been talking like the law, like the law was this. The law was not. It was not wicked. It was not evil. Just because you couldn't keep it don't make it wrong. I'm serious. If you hear some pastors talk about the law, you'll be thinking, man, I'm cast. God, the law, God just wiped it out. Wait a minute, hold up. First of all, if you hear any pastor start talking to you like God just wiped away the law, you need to get up and walk out of there anyway. Because that's not scripture. If you have any pastor say God, if you hear any pastor tell you God just did away with the law like that, That's not how it went down. Because if God just did away with it, then it must not have been righteous. Just because the law revealed that we were not righteous, it didn't make the law unrighteous. Don't y'all agree, right? I mean, it was in us already. All the law did was reveal it was there. So I hope some of y'all come back this evening, because we need to, because watch this. The law deal with two areas. I'm going to go into, just say this. The law deal with only two areas. It deals with a relationship with God and a relationship with one another. And we couldn't get it right with God, and we couldn't get it right with one another. That's why we needed grace. But grace, the Bible says he was full of grace and truth. So the only way the law would be really not valid at all, we would have to say it, there's no truth in it. And let me just say this real quick before. You shall not make idols. Is there any truth in that? That we should not make idols? I can't hear you. Is there no truth in it? So, because of grace, can you still make an idol? No. So, is truth in that? But guess what? Did we have idols? So, that truth revealed sin in us. Amen? And the wages of sin is what? Did Jesus come do away with the law, or did he do away with death? By doing what? Bringing you life. And in life, guess what? Y'all better get this. In life, you still can't have no idols. Amen? Well, we're going to go over that this evening. If there's anybody under my voice that has never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior,